It may sound strange, odd, or even bizarre if I say that spirituality is one of the most abused words. Not many who talk about spirituality seem to know the real meaning of spirituality. Is spirituality related to God or belief in God alone? Or is it selfishness or is it caring for others? Or is it meditation or other rituals? Or is it saying, my God is great and yours is the worst? Let us look at these verses of Kamban before attempting to answer the aforementioned questions. கல்லிடை பிறந்து போந்து கரிடை கலத்த நீத்தம் எல்லைகளில் மறைகளாலும் இயம் பரும் பொருள் ஈதன்ன தொல்லையில் ஒன்றேயாகி துறைதொறும் பரந்த சூழ்ச்சி பல்பெரும் சமயம் சொல்லும் பொருளும் போல் பரந்ததன்றே தாதுரு சோலை தோறும் ஷண்பக காடு தோறும் போதவள் பொய்கை தோறும் புதுமண தடங்கள் தோறும் மாதவி வேலி பூக வனந்தோறும் வயல்கள் தோறும் ஓதிய உடம்பு தோறும் உயிரன உலாயதன்றே The river which originates from the hills flows through the fields gardens, dense forests, and is known by different names depending on the place it flows through and the form it assumes. Likewise, the divine is one, though different names are given by different religions. There are many inner meanings to these verses, and I do not want to get into that now. What I would like to highlight, however, are a couple of things, and these will be said after looking at yet another Tamil verse. Aganamarnda anbinarai arupagai setru. ஐம்புலனும் அடக்கி ஞான புகழடையோர் தம் உள்ள புண்டரிகத்து உள்ளிருக்கும் புராணர் கோயில் தகவுடை நீர் மணித்தளத்து சங்குல வர்க்கம் திகழ சலசத்தீயுள் மிக உடைய புங்குமலர் பொறியிட்ட மனஞ்செய்யும் விடலையாமே Composed by a poet who is supposed to have had the divine blessing at a very young age and whose name itself has a connection with enlightenment. This verse, interestingly, has two parts and a deeper look would suggest the link between the two parts. In the first part, Thirunyana Sambandha defines a real and genuine Bhakta as the one who controls the five senses and the six enemies residing inside, which are lust, anger, meanness, desire, ego, and jealousy. He says such people are full of love and that the divine resides in their lotus-like heart. In the second part, he describes a wedding. Yes, the wedding of nature. He sees the temple pond at Thiruvir Midalai. The crystal clear water reminds him of a carpet. The huge white flowers of conches, the lotus right at the center of the pond of the sacred fire, the tiny flowers from the punugu tree which fall on the pond of the sacred rice. Seen through the poet's eyes, this is a wedding. Now, read the two parts and you can connect and relate the two. I am not getting into the hidden meanings now as there is a joy in self-discovery. Moreover, such verses are left to one's own interpretations. But I'd like to mention the commonalities between the verses of Kamban and the one of Thirunyana Sambandha. Both sing about the divine. Both see the nature from a different angle and appreciate the beauty. Both are musical in that melodious language called Tamil. Most importantly, one gets to know the real meaning of spirituality in the words of both the great poets. Now, let us go back to the beginning. After all, isn't it the beginning which leads us to everything in life? What is spirituality? Always having a calm mind, as crystal clear as a river, loving all, realizing that the divine is one and that it resides within oneself, and yes, worshipping and appreciating nature. Now what happens when somebody who is spiritual also analyzes everything and keeps discovering new things from time to time? Can he or she then be called as a scientist? And what happens when spirituality combines with artistic sensibility and with science? Wouldn't it then result in some beautiful and immortal works? In my opinion, Kamban and Jnana Sambandha belong to this category. And in this 21st century, if somebody is an embodiment of these qualities, it is Ilaiyaraaja. That is why his compositions are liked equally by a layperson as well as by a pandit. In some of my earlier Geetanjali special posts, I had mentioned that even agnostics and atheists feel the divine through music. Spirituality runs as an undercurrent in Ilaiyaraaja's music may not be known to many, but the fact reminds that people get attracted to his music because of this spirituality in his compositions. There are at least two more reasons for his music sounding great. One is the fact that he himself is a connoisseur. Two is his proclivity to doing things which are different and his propensity to experiment without in any way compromising on the classicism. The special song of this year's Geetanjali is an example, or rather, it is just yet another example of his analytical mind and his sense of aesthetics coupled with spirituality. In Ponnil Vanam from the film Villupattukaran, there is that sense of awe about nature. There is melody and there is spirituality. Above all, there is a very different raga. There are thousands of ragas in Carnatic music, but only some hundreds are used. Out of this, only some are very frequently used. In film music, no other composer has used ragas like Ilayaraja, not just in terms of quantity, but also in terms of quality. Though he has used many popular ragas, he has also used some very rare ragas, some of which were never used even by any classical musician. The raga called Khamas is very popular in Carnatic music. Ilayaraja has used this raga very classically in a couple of his compositions. People who follow Geetanjali will remember the special song of 2009, Margari Madam Unpani Velayile, based on this raga. But there is yet another raga whose second name is the same as this raga, and yet not many are aware of this raga. What is surprising is that this raga, whose name is Karnataka Khamas, has six swaras in both Arohana and Avrohana and is not popular, despite the structure being so simple. As far as I know, no classical music composer has used this raga. In film music too, it is Ilayaraja alone who has used this raga and has composed 20 plus songs in this raga. The raga sounds like Bahudari, and I have come across posts in the net which mentions the songs in this raga as being based on Bhagyashri or on Sriranjani. The connection between the latter and this raga anyway cannot be missed. If the Panchamam of Karnataka Khamas is assumed as the Adhara Shadja, one gets Sriranjani as per the principles of Gahadeva. Let's now look at this song and see how it sounds. The imagistic brevity of the prelude is striking. It just has the string sound from the keys, the opals, which of course does only the akaram and the flute. The ubiquitous bass guitar is of course used in lieu of percussion instrument. Revolving around the panchamam and the shadjamam, the keys produce the sound of the stringed instrument, which shines with radiance. It resembles the sound of the bells. Can any beginning be more auspicious than this? The intrinsically distinctive voice of Janaki starts the akara. Like a very obedient child, the flute follows each and every note of hers meticulously. The moment in the three-beat cycle tisram sans any percussion instrument makes the experience special. It is made more special with the sound of the bass guitar, which backs the vocals and the flute with great involvement. The sitar follows and makes her heart tender with its subtle sound. Is it pulling the special cards in her heart? With a sense of composure and poise, the Pallavi starts. And now we see the Ilayaraja. In fact, this Ilayaraja, who refrained from using any percussion instrument in the prelude, uses the tabla, which first plays the takita along with the first phrase, Ponnil. Immediately, the three is divided into six microbeats and the percussion plays taka taka dini. After this, it is taka dini taka with the stress on the first and the third syllable, with the fifth syllable being played rather subtly. The second, fourth and the sixth are left blank. The morsing, which is known for its unique sound, is played for every alternate cycle and only sounding the third syllable. This is what is Ilayaraja Mandira. The first interlude is an ideal balance of depth and sensitivity. To start with, the violins in higher octave touch some notes of Harikamboji rather innocuously. One sees the contours of Western classical music as the strings from the solo violin are sounded with fingers in the background. This technique is called as the pizzicato in Western classical music parlance. The beguilingly charming flute gives resplendent shades of the raga, with the sitar repeating the melody in its unique way. The flute plays another set of notes before a unique combination of the keys, sitar and the bass guitar illuminates the interlude and guides us to the first charana, which itself has a pleasant surprise in store. We get to see the beauty of yet another raga in the first two lines. No, the raga as such doesn't change here. Let me explain. As mentioned here earlier, Karnataka Khamas is a raga with six swaras. Take the swara ma out of it and we get Balaji, a rather popular raga. Here the maestro obscures the swara ma and makes us feel Balaji. The charanam gathers momentum in the second half with the percussion going in the faster mode. Intensity of feeling, or is it intense feeling? We see the subtleties of expression in the second interlude. The keys and the bass guitar join together and ripple reverberatingly. Even as this is on, the flute enters with slimline elegance and moves with zest. It is pizzicato yet again, but this time it is more prominent with the strings of the violin sounded with gusto with fingers. The superimposed higher octave violins play with gay abandon, albeit with an indescribable passion. The flute intersects again, giving slices of silkiness. The river dances in tisram in the second charana. Is water a metaphor for our life, or is it for spirituality? ask Kambal or Jnana Sambandha. Or better still, ask Jnana Desikan or keep listening to his compositions. You will find an answer.